I have Shervin Takyar. I've had him before. He's a great guest. He's an associate professor, part of the Yale School of Medicine, and he's going to be helping me out with the cancer book I'm putting together. So, Shervin, thanks for coming back.
Thank you for inviting me back.
Yeah, well, for listeners that don't know you, tell me a bit about your background and, in particular, your work on cancer, and then we'll get into the questions.
Sure. So, my background is I work on RNA biochemistry and biology. And I'm also a pulmonologist. I'm a practicing pulmonologist, so I see pulmonary patients, COPD patients. Also, I'm in intensive care and see lung injury patients. And so that's the two main things that I do, basic science and clinical science, or clinical medicine, rather. The work that we do in cancer, I think of it as a logical progression of what we do in lung disease. I don't know if the most fatal lung disease is lung cancer. And I think I look at lung cancer as a consequence of injury and disease in the lung. And I think most people agree with me that an injury will, or a process after injury, would lead to cancer. So that's how we got into it. I specifically work on endothelium, which is now part of, we all know, as a very important part of tumor microenvironment. And that's how I got into it. Yeah.
Well, very good. So what do you think causes cancer? You know, well, we could focus on lung cancer since that's what you focus on, but what are some of the reasons or the causes of lung cancer in your mind? I guess there's viral vectors, maybe there's bacterial vectors, there's physical damage. Like, how would you characterize the various ways that cancer can arise?
Yeah, I think it's a combination of things, the combination of reagents, and with some help from the body, from the tissue, from different cells in the tissue. I think a cancer, you know, it takes a whole team to cause cancer. It's not, I don't think, any single agent. I mean, there are instances where you see a specific agent or a virus like HPV, we all have heard, that increases the risk of cancer a lot. Again, it's not that everybody who gets that virus gets the cancer. Again, it's an interaction. So let me just say that in the beginning, I don't think anybody would ever find a single agent causing cancer, particularly in lung cancer. It's an accumulation of things. And what I am mostly focusing on is before cancer. And I am very glad that you asked the question this way. What is the cause of cancer? The majority of research in cancer is happening now in what should we do after the cancer happened. And as a pulmonologist, I like the question the other way. What can we do before the cancer happened? Like, what is it? What is that event? What are those events that predispose an individual to cancer? And then even beyond that, if this patient had the cancer removed, who are the people who will have a recurrence of that cancer? Who are the people who will have resistance to agents? So I think these questions are all extensions. I think, at least in the instances that I've seen in the lung or similar cancers in the upper airway, there is always a process of injury. So that's how I am coming into it. There is an injury of some sort. And this injury, the response to this injury, can increase the risk of a mistake. And that mistake is the start of cancer.
Why would a mistake turn into a deliberate kind of parallel evolution, you know, where cancer takes on, it grows and it recruits blood vessels and it seems to be like a separate organism that has its own homeostatic drive? Like, why do you think a mistake would translate all of a sudden into like a new organism, essentially, that has its own goals that are conflicting with our body?
So that's a very interesting question, depending on how this mistake happens. And we may be looking at a very evolved mistake. We may be looking at one of many, 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 many mistakes that had the chance to survive. So I think maybe we should put that in that context, that injury happened. There are a lot of responses. There are a lot of ways that cells are trying to get out of that phenotype, out of that blockage, maybe, if you want to call it. It's after, from that injured state, they want to get out of that state. One of the ways is by proliferation. Now, of course, if you have injury, you don't have all the machinery, and the cell can die or can survive by proliferating and making a clone.